For me, Mary Poppins, the original, was my first film that I saw as a child. When you see that iconic film on a big screen as a kid, for me, I think it shaped me.
Mary
Poppins. Close your mouth, please, Michael. We are still not a codfish.
We've been very careful to pay homage to the original, and yet this is the next chapter, and this is ultimately going to be my interpretation of her.
It's a good thing you come along when you did, Mary Poppins.
We're making a live-action original musical, which is very rare in this day and age.
How'd you do that?
We're on the brink of an adventure, children. Don't spoil it with too many questions. Off we go.
If you're going to take on something as special and unique as Mary Poppins and create the next chapter, you do need somebody as unique and meticulous as Rob Marshall and the whole team that he built around him, people who cared so deeply about the project.
That's a great idea.
Disney knew of my passion for the film. So when they brought it to me, I was incredibly excited, but also very nervous about it too. Because how do you do that? How do you follow that iconic film?
Here we go.
And I realized that the way to do that is to find a new story to tell with this iconic character.
Everything is possible, even the impossible.
Well, Rob and I, even before we had decided to do it, we did all our research. And culling through all the material, we started to create something new.
No, not yet.
What's wonderful about Mary Poppins is that she takes you on a journey that allows you to experience joy and wonder, and she doesn't take credit for it. She lets it be your experience, and she lets you go on that journey, and when you are healed by that, she doesn't expect anything in return. So by the end of the day, she denies it ever happened.
Tell her, Mary Poppins!
I have no idea what you're all talking about.
She's a very strong, stern, and strict nanny. But underneath, there's a child inside who has great joy and love and wonder, but that's hidden by this exterior.
My goodness gracious, glory me.
We wanted to find a reason for Mary Poppins to have to return. So we were looking for a story that showed that the world was not perfect.
That's when we came up with this idea that we would set the film 25 years later. In the 30s, during the Depression era, because the original books were written in that time period as well. And you feel that in the books, a family struggling to make it work.
Storm clouds, heading straight for Cherry Tree Lane.
Batten down the hatches, Mr. Binnacle. Rough seas ahead, I fear.
The original film was set in 1910, so that made Michael and Jane now 25 years older. And so I realized we could explore this next generation of the Banks family and what is happening in their lives at this time.
Don't you remember that kite? We used to love flying that with mother and father.
Those days are long behind me.
Michael Banks, the little boy from the original film, is now grown up, and he has three children. And before the film's begun, he's lost his wife, so he's a widower.
Everything's fallen to pieces since your mother.
And it is about people struggling, trying to deal with a real-life situation. It's not just fantasy.
Times are hard in London. It's a tough economic time, and Michael Banks is in danger of losing his home.
If you are unable to pay in full by Friday at midnight, I'm afraid we will have to repossess your home and you will have to vacate the premises.
And his kids have sort of grown up too fast.
What if Father does lose the house?
We'll just have to figure out a way to get it back, I suppose.
You're right. That's what Mother would do.
They've just sort of been forced into adulthood in a strange way, and then they've lost a bit of that childlike wonder, and in comes Mary Poppins to take care of the Banks family again.
You need to be more careful when the wind rises, George. You nearly lost your kite. And you too nearly lost your Georgie.
She's there for the children to help ignite their sense of wonder that they've lost, but she's mostly there for the adults.
What brings you here after all this time?
Same thing that brought me the first time. I've come to look after the Banks children.
Us?
Oh yes, you too.
Ultimately, her plan is to get the family to become whole again, and also to remember wonder and joy and find that childlike spirit inside.
Well, we have grown up a good deal in the past year, after all.
Well, we'll have to see what can be done about that.
Rob's meticulous preparation and the time he took, the length of time he took writing and creating this film was so important.
They start to levitate and then they start to swirl all around.
under Rob's leadership and guidance that everybody's been encouraged to be there and respond and react and be in the moment. And so he's guided us all through the story and through finding these characters.
And Rob has created this environment where you really feel like a family, you know?
Give it up the moose dream!
It was so cool!
It's a theatrical sense of joy that he brings, and certainly in the exuberant, life-affirming showbiz numbers that he can stage like nobody else. There's nobody else that could do this.
He adapted Chicago to the screen, and he's a wizard to me. Him and John, the way they evoke music on screen is always so thrilling.
Listen, soon the slumber.
Right, it goes right into soon.
There was this goal to make sure we were honoring the first film, but also at the same time, creating something completely original on its own.
Although I will want my old room back, that's if it's not a complete disaster. And I will insist on having every second Tuesday
off. Afraid
of course, Mary Poppins. Good, good, that's all settled. Then I'll stay.
When the early morning hours have come and gone.
I'd never done an original musical. When we started on it, I felt that this was a perfect world. You have to make sure it's a story that sings.
Count your blessings, you're a lucky guy. For you're underneath the lovely London sky.
I went to work with my collaborators, John DeLuca, David McKee, and Mark Shaman and Scott Whitman, who wrote the score. And we worked together to create a seamless musical.
I love that.
Okay, cool.
Which is maybe one of the hardest things in the world, to create an original musical without a Broadway version of it first. We had to do all that while we were filming, while we were rehearsing, while we were creating.
Keep on looking high while you're underneath the lovely London sky.
I know everyone must say this, but I'm the ultimate Mary Poppins fanatic. So the idea of a sequel was very daunting. The original film is obviously just perfect. And the Sherman brothers were clearly touched by God and were writing the most perfect songs you could ever imagine.
The score by Mark Shaman and Scott Whitman, I think, is extraordinary because it feels very familiar in that you're in sort of the Mary Poppins world, but it's an all-new score.
The monster when adventure calls, can you imagine that?
We sat here paralyzed with terror, but eventually you have to put pen to paper, so we just sat down and lived the characters in our heads and started writing the score.
Mark and Scott were integral when we were writing the script, so they knew where we would need a number and exactly why it was needed and how strong it was for the story.
I would write up to where I thought the song kicked in, and I would hand over what I did to Mark and Scott. It was a magic collaboration.
The first song that they did was Where the Lost Things Go. And they just tapped into something, and they just got it.
Do you ever dream or reminisce, wondering where to find what you truly miss? Well, maybe all those things that you love so are waiting in the place where the lost things go.
It comes at a very, very tender moment. And Mark and Scott, they just understand the soulfulness, the heart that needed to be in this little nursery for the three children and Mary.
Trust she's always there, watching as you grow. Find her in the place where the lost things go.
It's been wonderful to learn the music, to see Mark and Scott's exciting original new songs. And it's really exciting to be there as an actor and be a part of it all.
We had over 2 months of rehearsal, which is the best way to create a company.
Royal Dalton Music Hall.
When creating something as such a spectacle as this is, You need rehearsals. You need to make sure that everything feels good and detailed to people.
Coming from the theater world, I feel so spoiled. I know that when you're making a movie, you never get as much rehearsal time as we've gotten. I mean, months and months of practice, and it takes a lot of hard work for something to feel natural.
Oh, Don?
Rob has tremendous imagination to create sequences that are in the real world, that are big dance numbers, that are CG worlds of underwater splendor.
Gather around, everyone, Spitzbot.
And also, remarkably, a whole animated sequence that combines live action, old-fashioned Disney animation, and contemporary CG backgrounds and 3D animation.
When we launch into the animation world, there's a wonderful showbiz music hall number that happens on the stage of the music hall, which is called A Cover Is Not the Book.
A cover is not the book, so open it up and take a look.
Which was maybe the most challenging thing I've ever done, to work with animators to create this live-action animation sequence, which is all hand-drawn.
First impression was mistook. Cover is nice, but cover is not the book.
And that was probably the most dancing I had to do. That was day one of rehearsals, was we started to dance. And we ran that thing for 8 weeks, over and over and over again. Rob just said you need it in your body. It's got to be in your body so that on the day when the cameras are rolling, you don't have to think about it, that you feel safe.
Oh, the cover is not the book, so open it up and take a look, 'cause under the covers one discovers that the king may be a crook.
Working with Emily on finding that dance together with our amazing choreographers was just such a joy, because we did have a lot of input in terms of how we really move and this sort of incredible old-timey music hall number. That was really a joy to behold.
And I absolutely adored being a part of the massive lamplighter, triple little light, fantastic, huge dance number. That was when I was like, I cannot believe how lucky I am that I get to do this.
You ready?
Yeah!
All right. Here we go. Playback.
Myself and John DeLuca and Joey Pizzi, who's our co-choreographer, this was what we love. Rarely do you get a chance to do a big choreographed number on this scale with this many people, with dancers, stuntmen, actors, of course, and children. You know, it's a lot of moving parts, and it's a big challenge.
Preparing the whole shoot for this. We're ready.
When you all pull together and you start to work on a big number like that, it's thrilling for everyone, because it's the big sort of centerpiece choreographed number in the film.
We knew that our vocabulary would come from what the lamplighters use in their jobs. And it's the ladders, the bicycles, their lighting poles, and do these death-defying things. It was not easy stuff they're doing.
It was about a week and a half filming that sequence, and it was so worth it. We had just the best time. I imagine it's what a marathon runner feels like. You tell someone, I'm working on the sequel to Mary Poppins. Sequel to Mary Poppins? They say, instinctively defending that movie they love, who's playing Mary Poppins? And they say, Emily Blunt. I think that's been sort of the universal reaction.
I thought we'd never see you again.
It is wonderful to see you.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
Oddly enough, it was the easiest choice because I had worked with Emily on a film called Into the Woods. And because I knew that Emily has great vulnerability as well as strength, she's very funny. And at the same time, there's a warmth, because underneath this very stern and strict nanny is this warm person who wants this family to heal.
Nothing's gone forever, only out of place.
And by the way, she sings and she dances.
She is what we call a triple threat. She's a wonderful actress, she's a marvelous singer, and she can dance.
She was the only choice for me.
For when you dream, you find all that's lost.
Rob came to me and he said, I really want to do it and I only want to do it with you. And if you don't want to do it, then I may just find something else. Because he said, I see you. And I was like, oh my God. Like, it was just so exciting and flattering and thrilling and scary. And I want to be a bit scared taking something on at this point.
It takes a lot of courage to be able to do that. But she just kind of put her blinders on and did the work.
And I read all of the books, and she just leapt off the page at me. She is so enigmatic and batty and vain and rude and all of these things that were, like, so delightful to play.
Right, that's enough.
The first day we were in rehearsals and Emily walked in as Mary Poppins, she already was the character. She had a laser sense of who this person was.
May I say you look lovely as always?
Do you really think so? Nice to see you, Jack.
Good to see you too, Mary Poppins.
Lin-Manuel Miranda plays Jack, who's a lamplighter. They called them Learys at the time. And they literally would light all of the gas lamps around London.
And Jack takes us through the streets of London, introduces us to the world.
You ever need a ladder raised or a lamp lit, consider it done.
Well, I have to say, John DeLuca came up with the idea of Lin-Manuel.
It's that childlike quality he has, which is so important to the film, finding the child within. He just owns that. He lives it.
Rob Marshall and John DeLuca asked to have a meeting, and so I met with them across the street from Hamilton on a two-show day. I was between shows, and they said Emily Blunt's Mary Poppins, and I basically was in from that moment on.
Give Mary Poppins a chance. You need help just as much as she does.
Very well, she can stay for the time being, I suppose.
Ben Whishaw, he plays Michael, is the heart of the film. It's his story. It's his story about overcoming grief and rediscovering joy in life again.
There's something incredibly moving about now at 36 finding myself back in this world that I was so enchanted by as a little one. And it's sort of over the course of the film, it's my character and my sister Jane, played by Emily Mortimer, sort of come to realize that Mary Poppins has returned not only for Michael's children, but for Michael and for Jane too.
Those things when we were young, they didn't really
happen.
No.
Of
course not.
Ridiculous.
Ben Whishaw and I are brother and sister in the movie, and I really feel like I wish he was my brother. And Rob has chosen these performers incredibly well.
Are you sure this is quite safe?
Not in the slightest. Ready?
Ben and Emily sort of became siblings right away on set. As soon as you see them in the costume, you go, of course. And they're the Banks children. They've all grown up.
The same with our three children. They don't feel like actors. You feel like you're watching a family.
Maybe have balloons.
Yes, of course we can. Let's go.
Meryl Streep is my favorite actor of all time. We found a character in the P.L. Travers books called Fred Turvey, but we changed it from a man to a woman for Meryl.
Everything is turning turtle.
What exactly does that mean?
It's my whole world goes flippity-flop like a turtle on his back.
Tatiana Antanasia Kozitori Topotrebelovsky is her name. You may call me Topsia. She is Mary Poppins' cousin. Many times removed.
Yes, I think we've all grasped the concept.
Good. That's quick for you.
We have a somewhat contentious relationship, which was really fun to play.
Literally, her house turns upside down, and so she has to live on her ceiling. It's just a great metaphor for when your world is upended by whatever comes along.
And why? Because the world is turning turtle.
All these actors wanted to be part of this film because of what we are trying to do to give people hope. Major actors like Colin Firth, like Julie Walters, who's now a dame, as is Angela Lansbury, a Disney legend as well, a legend in so many ways.
And you've forgotten what it's like.
To hold a balloon.
To be a child.
She's a sort of a magical character, and I couldn't resist it. So I was delighted to be included.
It was so moving when Angela Lansbury and Dick Van Dyke came on set, because I think people don't quite realize until those people are in front of you just how much they've impacted your life.
When Dick Van Dyke said he would do this film, that was a childhood dream come true.
I was so honored to be asked, and of course I was still alive, which helped. It was just a joy to do every day. I had a lot of hard work and a lot of dancing.
Well, that's the step we're looking for.
Step.
And it was fun. I got a few steps left in me.
I mean, he's 91, and to see him kicking his legs up higher than I could do, jumping on a table and dancing brilliantly, he made most of us feel a bit like a child again.
That's the incredible thing about Dick Van Dyke, is you work with him and you just want to have more energy and you want to have more zest for life because he's never lost it.
We all just knew something good was happening. Just, it was a magical, everybody had the spirit.
Primed and ready, Mr. Binnacle.
Ready and charged, sir.
When you create a world, the challenge is always that everyone is creating the same world. There are so many moving parts to it, whether it's design, lighting, costumes. It all has to be of a world.
Fire! Good heavens! Are you housing anarchists?
No, that's the Admiral next door. He fires off a cannon to mark the hour.
What's interesting about the production design, I made a decision early on that I really wanted to bring reality to the film so that in juxtaposition with these great fantasies, there would be two worlds. So I asked my production designer, John Meyer, to help me find a way to use London in real places and real streets so that we could feel that we're actually in a real place.
The scale is huge. It did feel like a very, very big film, from the sets to the shooting outside Buckingham Palace.
We've been lucky to build a lot of sets. I think we had 10 stages at Shepperton Studios that we built sets in, shot them, tore them out, built new sets in.
Now!
We've even built pieces of Big Ben. And there's a big section of a beautiful old abandoned park with an old broken down greenhouse, an old disused fountain that was ended up using for a huge dance number with Jack and the other Learys.
Morning, Jack.
I'll never forget the moment we walked into the soundstage right across from this and saw 17 Cherry Tree Lane. That was a really thrilling moment.
We were able to build all of Cherry Tree Lane, a whole street we built inside, that we saw both in the winter and then in the spring.
You're back home.
Good
morning. There you are.
It's perfect.
They rebuilt Cherry Tree Lane with the park and everything. They let me go see it. My God, it was like a trip to the past.
Winds from the east. Oh. Like something is happening or about to be here.
Every set was so beautifully crafted and real and transporting. And we all discovered the magic in it. There's a whole sequence with Meryl Streep's character where we're in an upside down room.
From down here, things look right side up.
That was an amazing set to walk into because the set was built upside down. So when you walked in, you're like, oh, we're standing on the ceiling, that's the floor. It was a very complicated set.
Hey, Mom.
I wouldn't mind one myself.
Well, I suppose it wouldn't do any harm.
I think the first hint we got of how surreal things would get were when we got to try on Sandy Powell's incredible costumes. And we went, oh my gosh, what are we in for?
Sandy Powell is an extraordinary artist, and I was very excited to work with her. And Mary has her own little eccentricity, but she also has great style and cares about her look. She's very vain, which I love that about the character, and always looking in mirrors and things like that.
She's not a fuddy-duddy in any way. She loves clothes, she loves shoes, and she loves how people react to her. And so Sandy knew how to make me feel that, the extension of how I wanted to play her.
I don't see why that couldn't be arranged.
Mary Poppins needs to be sophisticated, but not frivolous. Sort of on one hand sensible, on the other hand stylish. So I felt that soft colours and florals weren't for her, and I went for quite strong, bold, geometric shapes and patterns within the fabric, which were technically correct for the period.
And then when we launch into the fantasies, then she could just go into these original ideas. Sandy had this wonderful idea of hand painting all of the costumes in that animation world so that it would blend more naturally into the actual hand-drawn backgrounds. I mean, when you look at Mary Poppins' skirt, for instance, there are a series of ruffles. There are no ruffles. It looks like there's tiers of ruffles. It's all hand-painted. It was brilliant what she did. One of the joys of working on a film like this and the challenges is to coordinate all of that The animators, the costume designers, the lighting designers, Dion Beebe, my DP. I mean, he and I share a very similar sensibility, and we really wanted to create real London of that era, of the 30s. Foggy, textured world. Dion is a master of light, and he knows how to find the story in the lighting.
The Spring Fair! It's today, can we go?
Please?
I don't see why not.
Watching Mary Poppins Returns, it's almost like wrapping yourself in a blanket of comfort for 2 hours, and you kind of don't want to take the blanket off when the film is over.
One thing you should know about Mary Poppins, she never explains anything.
It is about cherishing what you have. It is about how the way you choose to experience something affects your life and your family and your outset.
Today or never, that's my motto.
Ow!
This is a film that's completely uncynical, and I think people don't even realize how much they might need an experience like this.
Of course, the grown-ups will all forget by tomorrow.
They always do.
This was the most personal film I've ever done, the most challenging film I've ever done, because it's original, because the bar was so high and we were reaching so high. But I felt like this message needed to get out into the world, especially right now. It's such a fragile world, some will say a dark world, but can we look for the light? And the best thing about the character of Mary Poppins is that she is taking things in her hand and trying to show to the world that you can see life through a child's eyes, and that's how you get through a dark time, and that's why you have to find that child within.
Thank you, Mary Poppins.